Working a 10-hour day is not fun. I do not recommend it. Hello, Internet. This is Olin from What I'm Listening To. Hope you all are continuing to stay safe, stay healthy, keeping those hands nice and clean, and you are wearing that mask when you are going outside. For today's video, I have decided to do another volume of a series that I haven't done in a long, long time. That series I'm talking about is the experimental vlog series. Woo! These are the series of videos where I talk strictly about experimental music. Around the time I'd moved to the city about 3 years ago, I was making experimental vlogs all the time. I think I've made about 5 volumes at this point. They were some of my favorite videos I made because I was so passionate about experimental music, and I just wanted to share all the cool, weird-sounding records I'd picked up. And even though I've fallen off making these videos in the recent days, I still do enjoy experimental music. I still buy experimental albums here and there. There's some experimental albums that appear in various videos I've posted recently, but it's been a long, long time since I've made a dedicated video to experimental music. So today, I've decided let's do that. I have so many experimental albums that I have not talked about in a video, so I went through the collection here and I selected a good portion of them. I still have a lot of stuff in here that I didn't pick for this particular session. It may appear on later sessions, but for now, I chose a good hearty chunk of experimental albums that have never appeared in a video, so with that being said, let's jump right into them. And the first album I'm gonna talk about here, I have Steve Reich's Music for 18 Musicians. This is the most recent CD I got. In fact, it's actually the inspiration behind this very video. One of my co-workers, Mark, is really into experimental music and weird electronica music, and every so often when I see him, we talk about current stuff we've listened to, stuff that we share mutual love for, and all that kind of stuff. The last time I saw him, he brought this CD with me and said, I have a box of CDs that have just been sitting in my basement for ages, and I saw this and I thought, I think Olin's gonna like this, so I think you should have this. I had heard the name Steve Reich before, but never actually listened to any of his works. So when I popped this into my car on my drive home from work, I was blown away by it. It's one piece, 58 minutes long, but that's very, very typical for early avant-garde electronic music. Very minimal sounding music, but composed as if it were a classical piece. And it sounds a lot like something you'd hear off the orchestral bits on a Sufjan Stevens record. And as the title of the album suggests, there are 18 musicians that have contributed, all of which are listed on the back here. I wish I had more to say about this guy. I don't know much about him, like I said. I want to show off this CD because it was given to me and I really, really enjoyed it. And to thank Mark for giving this to me. This is excellent. The next album I have for you today, I have Onetrix Point Never's Riffs. I have definitely talked about Onetrix in various videos, but I've never actually talked about this album in a video. This is a compilation featuring Onetrix's first 3 releases. When I was just getting into Onetrix Point Never's work, I was seeking out everything I could find of his. In a very short period of time, I collected, I think like 4 of his, no, maybe even 5 of his albums. Returnal, Replica, R+7, the collaboration he did with Tim Hecker. Basically, anything I could get my hands on by him, I grabbed. And then I saw this compilation and thought, I have to have this. It's 3 albums in 1 packaging. Let's get it. compared to the other albums he's done, this stuff is a little different. It's similar in atmosphere and quality, but you can tell that he's just kind of figuring himself out as an artist under the project name and just kind of playing around with electronics. One of the reasons I like this project so much is it's just so reminiscent of the 80s. It's got kind of the soundtrack to like an 80s horror movie with all the synths, all the weird melodies, but of course it's all twisted, chopped up, manipulated, and just made into something completely odd. Yeah, this is a great compilation. Really, anything by One Trick Point Never is fantastic. So if you haven't listened to any of his stuff, you can check this album out. This is his first three albums, and then just listen to everything else he's done. It's definitely a trip. The next albums I have for you today, I have four here. They're all by the same person. This is a project called Halastrana. I mentioned this project in my albums that don't have a CD release video, and I never actually got to talk about the main albums that he did put out on CD. But let me back up a little bit. So this is a project created by guitarist Stephen R. Smith, who's done numerous experimental guitar-driven projects. My first exposure to Stephen's music was through his project Ulan Cole. I found the second release he put out under that project name in the clearance section of the experimental area in Amoeba, and grabbed it mostly because of the cover, and also because it was $1.99. And I loved the album. I loved how droney and kind of sludgy it sounded, all while being just only guitar, only instrumental music. It's very minimal. It just sounded great. So naturally, I started exploring the Ulan Cole project, and I stumbled across Stephen's Bandcamp, and that's where I found all the stuff he worked on, under his own name, under Ulan Cole, and Halastrana. Halastrana, though, is much different sounding than Ulan. On the Halastrana project, Stephen takes heavy influence on Eastern European folk music, and he composes these weird, folky, Renaissance-y sounding pieces, but also includes drone, ambient, some field recordings, just kind of turning the genre on its head. I think the first album I listened to was this one right here, Fielding, and it's fantastic. The moment I listened to this record, I thought, fuck, I love this. I gotta listen to the rest. And I ended up buying all of the albums that I could get on CD with the project name. I'm not gonna lie, everything done by this project is phenomenal. If you've heard one record by this and you love it, you need to check out all of these records. I guess I'm a sucker for Eastern European music, but I also am a sucker for experimental music, so having the two come together on a series of albums was a no-brainer for me. I will leave a link in the description to his Bandcamp where you can listen to these albums. Absolutely essential. Everything he's done is great. And as of this recording, I've seen on his Instagram that he's reissuing a lot of these albums on vinyl for the first time, so if you'd prefer to get these on vinyl, now is your chance. The next album I have for you today, I have an album by a band called The Violent Magic Orchestra. The Violent Magic Orchestra, or VMO for short, is a Japanese band that features the contributions from Pete Swanson of the Yellow Swans. And what they do on this project is take influences of black metal, noise, electronica, IDM, and just mush it together and creates this insanely brutal, chaotic sounding album. The selling point for me to get this album was it was described as if Aphex Twin made a black metal album. If that doesn't sound appealing to you, then you may want to avoid the record. But if you are a fan of weird electronica black metal, this is absolutely something you have to check out. Really, anything that has Pete Swanson associated with it, I usually will pick up. I love that guy. I love all the stuff he does, the Yellow Swans, his solo stuff. Really, anything he does is great. So yeah, this album, definitely, definitely check out. Link in the description to their Bandcamp. Well worth the listen. And staying on the topic of Pete Swanson, we may as well just talk about the two Yellow Swans albums I have here today. This one is called Going Places, which is one of their more popular ones, and then this one is called Drowner. I could have picked one or the other to talk about in this video, but I decided to talk about them both because of the Yellow Swans albums I have in my collection, these two are definitely my favorites. In fact, Going Places was the first Yellow Swans album I ever listened to. I happened to stumble across this album at Amoeba San Francisco in the experimental section and was captivated by the cover. Back when I first started exploring the experimental section at Amoeba, I didn't know a single experimental artist whatsoever. So when I would flip through CDs and see covers like this, I would be amazed and I would think, I don't know who this is, what this is gonna sound like, but I love this cover. I'm gonna buy it. Let's check it out. This is one of those albums where, to me, album art can make or break a purchase, and I'm so glad I bought this album. And when I listened to this record, I was instantly in love. It was noise music that had this sort of dark atmosphere, but also was, in a way, kind of melodic. And ultimately, this album led me to buy this album, and many, many more Yellow Swans records. This album I actually found at Amoeba Oakland, and as it turns out, it's actually a CDR release. And that's something that's pretty common in the Yellow Swans discography. They do a lot of collaborations, they have a lot of independently released CDRs, only a handful of official album releases. This one actually is one of those official albums. But this, I really, really like. This one actually sounds very, very similar to that of Going Places. Noisy, kind of melodic, it's just good, chaotic stuff. I have since collected a lot of Yellow Swans albums. Let's see if I can... Up here we go. So here's a bunch of other Yellow Swans albums. This one I've definitely talked about in a vlog. Oh, and this one I've talked about in a vlog. But yeah, anytime I find material by this band, I will snag it because I love their stuff so much. So if you fancy yourself some good, dark, chaotic noise music, then the Yellow Swans are definitely for you. Let's stay on the topic of noise music. The next album I have for you today, I have Zulu Time by Casper Brodsman and Paige Hamilton. I don't really have a lot to say about this record other than the fact that I was pretty blown away by it when I saw it. And what I mean by that is because of Paige Hamilton. Prior to finding this album, my only exposure to Paige Hamilton was his time in the band Helmet. But I later found out that Paige was pretty well known in the underground scene when he was just getting started. He played guitar in a band called Band of Susans, he played guitar in Glenn Branca's orchestra for a time, and then he even did a lot of experimental stuff like this. And on this album, Paige and guitarist Casper Brodsman collaborate and make this sort of back and forth, noisy, sludgy kind of sounding record. Some people describe it as jazz, but it's not jazz as you'd expect it to be. Whatever you want to call it, it's good, good stuff. Nice, noisy, heavy music. Yeah, I really dig it. If you haven't checked it out, definitely recommend it. It's a cool record. And speaking Speaking of collaborations, the next album I have for you today, I have a collaboration between Daniel Menchi and Mammifer. This is an interesting project with two parties I don't think I would have ever expected to come together. Daniel Menchi is most known for his kind of music concrete field recording stuff he does, whereas Mammifer is a duo consisting of vocalist Faith Colochia and guitarist Aaron Turner of Isis. And while their music is pretty experimental and ambient unto itself, it's not quite as weird sounding as Daniel's stuff. But from what I read is the parties came together because they all shared a mutual love for field recording material and they wanted to do something together in that realm. And ultimately, that became the material on this album, which is called Crater. And the album does an amazing job of blending field recordings, music concrete, ambient, some electronica music, all together. I absolutely recommend checking this album out. The very first track is one of the best experimental pieces I've ever listened to. Easily one of my favorites. I go back to it all the time. Beautiful sounding record. If these guys ever make another album together, absolutely gonna buy it. Okay, the next album I have for you today, this one is actually really, really cool. So this is an album by a project called Secret Flowers. Secret Flowers is an ambient drone project done by my friend Anthony. We actually started talking to one another through Instagram. I posted a lot of experimental music on the Wilt page. He also posted a lot of experimental music, and naturally we just kind of started talking and found that we liked a lot of the same groups. Eventually he started making music under this project, and of course I had to support him because, well, he was my friend and I figured, hey, he's making music that we both enjoy, so yeah, let's check it out. But he's a big fan of the cassette format, so the albums he puts out are usually only released on cassette if you want a physical version, or digitally on Bandcamp. But because he knows I love CDs, he was really, really cool and decided to make a CDR copy for me. He only did 5 copies of this. It looks like I have 3 of 5. So he did that and he sent it to me and I couldn't have been more excited. It's very minimal, as you can tell, but you know what? That's just kind of the nature of a lot of experimental artists. They work with what they got, very limited materials, as long as they can get their music out. It's all that matters. But yeah, this is great ambient stuff. Anyone who's a fan of Stars of the Lid or Kyle Bobby Dunn should absolutely check this out. I will leave a link in the description so you can check out his Bandcamp. Thank you, Anthony, so very much for making me this CD. I love it so much. Keep doing you, man. The next CDs I have for you today, I have The Caretakers Everywhere at the End of Time. The Caretaker is an amazing ambient producer. He's done so many projects, not even just under the Caretaker name, but just tons and tons of other experimental projects that are equally as good. But The Caretaker is a project where old 30s, 40s recordings are taken and manipulated and turned into these weird kind of loops with crackles and pops. Sometimes they're manipulated in such a way to where things are drawn out, they skip, but it's overall a very haunting and slightly disturbing thing to listen to. And not only that, but the music serves as a concept, usually dealing with some sort of mental disorder. And on this project, The Caretaker plays with the concept of dementia. The beginning of the album starts with those aforementioned recordings of old-timey sounding music, crackles and pops just looped over and over again. But as the album gradually progresses, the music starts to deteriorate, starts to sound much more warbled. Ultimately, at the very end, it doesn't completely sound like music at all. It's just noise, it's just echoes. And that's what the music is trying to represent. In the beginning, you still have those memories, but as your brain starts to eat away, you start losing those memories, all until you're left with nothing. It's, again, a really, really, really haunting experience. All spread out on, I think, 6 discs here. Let's see, 1, 2, 3 on this volume here. And 1, 2, 3, 4. Ooh, even more. 7 discs of material. And the packaging is just beautiful. Like, all this artwork is disturbing, it's thought-provoking, it's weird, but that's the nature of the Caretaker's music. I absolutely recommend checking out this. This particular project is fantastic. I'd say it's a good gateway into the Caretaker's material. He's got a lot of similar sounding stuff, but this right here is the one to get into. Alright, Internet, the last album I have for you today, this is a 3-disc compilation of Lauren Maskin Connor's work. I have wanted to talk about this album in a video for so long, and for whatever reason, I just couldn't get it into a video. There have been attempts, but none of them ever fell into fruition, until now. I have talked about Lauren Maskin Connor's in various videos. He is one of my favorite experimental guitarists ever. He started making music in the 70s, which to me was crazy because really the only experimental music that was out there was stuff going on in the New York scene with Lamont Young, Steve Reich, and all those guys. But Lauren's approach to music was very much inspired by the blues. He would do these weird sounding recordings where he would riff around on a guitar and kind of do these like weird sort of moans and groans and howls to really capture the blues or the sadness he was feeling. But over time, he just started playing whatever he could play. His whole thing with music is he would hit record and just play guitar, and whatever he came up with, that was it. And it wasn't until the 90s where his music was discovered, and a lot of people who loved experimental music started embracing him. And this album is a collection of works from 1976 to 2004, all span on 3 discs. I hope they don't all fall out. Yep, there they are. My first exposure to him was through the Harmony of the Spears compilation, which I have talked about so much in various videos. And ever since hearing the stuff he contributed on that compilation, I wanted to hear more. But unfortunately, a lot of the stuff Lauren has put out were all either self-released, limited pressings, CDRs, you get the idea. Similar to the Yellow Swans, Lauren Maskin Connor's is a musician where anytime I see something by him that I don't own, I buy it. Because I never knew whether it was rare or if I was ever going to see it again. But this, to me, was the Motherlode. I bought this at Amoeba Berkeley. I did not expect to find it, nor did I realize that something like this existed. I think it was like $30, but to be honest, I didn't care. I saw it and I thought, holy shit, 3 discs of Lauren Maskin Connor's music? Fuck, I gotta buy this. It's to this day one of my favorite compilations. It has really, really piqued my interest in Lauren's music. And since buying this, I've purchased a lot of his other albums. So let's see what I can find here. Okay, all that right there. And then over here, we have even more. Yeah, I think that's all of it. Yeah, so all of this is all Lauren Maskin Connor's CDs that I've collected over the years. Some I've talked about in various videos, but for the most part, this is all stuff, yeah, I've never talked about. What you should know is I love Lauren's music. I love it so much. It's all so interesting to listen. Some of it is beautiful, some of it is really abrasive, but all of it, for the most part, is very thought-provoking. And he's still around today in his 80s performing music, which is crazy to me. One of these days, I'd like to meet him or even see a performance. It's probably not gonna happen anytime soon because of the coronavirus. That sucks, but hopefully, if we get through this to the point where we can go see live music, and he happens to be in San Francisco, you can bet I will be there. All Alrighty then, internet, that does it for me. Hey, if you have any bands or albums you want me to check out, particularly in the experimental realm, leave a comment down below, and if I like it, maybe I'll include it in a follow-up experimental vlog. Also, if you like this video, be sure to hit that subscribe button. It'll show me the support and I'll love your face for it. And you can also follow me on Instagram for even more music. I post a new album on there semi-frequently, talk a little bit about it, and it gives you a bit of an insight of what else is in my collection. So, thank you all so very much for watching. This is Olin from What I'm Listening To, signing out. Goodbye.